insurance sales and telecom operations. He's also certified learning and development manager from the Carleton Management Institute of USA. I would like to welcome you, sir, to add glory to this session.
Thank you so much, Swati, for sharing the details. I was listening to Rahul and it was really interesting. I've been active on social media for quite a while now. But really with the current pace of work and the challenges, it becomes very difficult to map up and match up with the industry. So I think I'm going to more talk about my experience with how technology, how latest trends, how industry is changing over the period of time. And as an organization, as an industry, what are we doing to fill this gap, right? So I think I'll share a few slides I had prepared. I'll just put them on and we can talk more about it. Let me know when you can see my screen.
Yes, sir. Your screen is
visible now. Okay. So while I was preparing certain notes and slides for this presentation, I also realized that I'll talk more about some live examples as an HR professional, we have been going to a lot of campuses in the last 10 years. I've been in Scotts for now almost 10 years and more than 10 years, in fact. And there has been a huge change in terms of the education, the exposure, and the kind of experience that we see in the children, in the candidates when we go to campuses. And I think I'll talk more in terms of the reality that is coming as an industry, what they need. So with some slides talking about what do we need to do. So a few slides just primarily talks about how the Indian agriculture industry has evolved over a period of time. So post-partition, I think it's more of the agriculture which was dependent on farming. Even today, about more than 60% of the population in India are engrossed in agriculture sector. Now, when we say agriculture sector, it does not mean that everybody is doing farming. But what we're saying is they're involved in some or the other value chain of the entire agriculture sector. Now, when we look at the kind of farming and the mechanization has evolved over a period of time, even today, we stand about 37-38% of the mechanization across the globe. So if we look at more developed countries like US, they have about 96-95% of mechanization today. That means the total population that is engaged in agriculture is about 3-4%. There are various other factors also in terms of land holdings, in terms of how the agriculture inputs in terms of seeds, in terms of soil preparation, how that has evolved over a period of time. And what is the future of agriculture? What we're looking at is because it is very close to engineering in terms of automotive, in terms of agriculture sector, mechanical engineering, the future is going to be being connected, being autonomous, being self-driving vehicles, being getting into alternative fuel structure. Because the way we are consuming, let me talk about first about the requirement for sustaining life. So today, the population of India is increasing. I think we're going to surpass China by 2025, and we all have contributed to it, right? So when we look at the requirement of food grain in India, now these all information data is available on all the sites which government publish in terms of the food population metric ton requirement, what has been in the last couple of years. So what I understand, more than 335 metric ton of food grains are required to sustain us to have at least food in India. Now, that means that either the per hectare production needs to go up, either the solution of creating alternate mechanism of distribution or storage is been done, in next couple of years we are definitely going to lose out on the food grains that we will need at least to survive. So the future definitely lies in the connecting various models where we can increase the food production, where we can look at sustainable source of energy, where we can look at per hectare land production increase. Now there are various factors that contributes towards it, and I'll get more into details once we talk about. So we looked at some of the report. This is a report by PwC 2019, which talks about how various trends in the automotive sector and in agriculture sector have changed the evolution of the industry over a period of time. So when we look at these five pointers, well, I'll talk more about it, starting from rapidly evolving from customer expectations. So today, I'll talk about a car or I'll talk about a tractor. When we go to sell a tractor to a farmer, today the person actually goes to a mobile and see all the you know, features, videos, that whether the tractor can actually do these things or not. So there is a huge demand. Now we expect, very, very recent example, we expect our food to be delivered within the time that we, you know, been promised on Zomato or Swiggy. Now that is the level of expectation that we all have increased within ourselves as a customer. And it is coming out to be really, really high in the next couple of years. The change in the customer expectation is going to go up. Similarly, in terms of when we look at the regulatory environment, there is a huge change, especially in the last couple of years, everything has become digital. So I remember in 2014-15, when we used to look at compliances and regulatory, statutory compliances, there never used to be so much of impact in terms of what needs to be done, how needs to be done. Today, there are every month, there are reviews happening on compliances and sharing that why it is so important for us to be compliant. It is not only about understanding the processes and regulations, but it's also about filling them on time with the accurate data. Because everything that is you are filling in information today is going to society, going to the government bodies, they are all reviewing it. And there has been a huge demand in terms of how Bharat Stage 4, 5, 6, how they have impacted the automotive sector. Now they'll be getting into agriculture sector also. So carbon emission norms, how they have been regularly changing the face of the automotive sector. And please understand, there is a huge change or the need to you know, match up with the competitive environment. Indian consumers are still very price sensitive. So when we go in the market and they find a similar kind of a model or a vehicle available in the market, they may even look at the, you know, leaving out their attachment with the brand, because at the end of the day, it all boils down to price. So there has been a huge change in terms of how we are doing our business, what kind of wastage in industries are taking out, how those wastages have been, you know, properly been taken care. So there is a huge change that has happened. Third, there is a disruptive impact of technology. Now moving in from, you know, going to a mall, to a small shopping place, to finding things on your handset. You know, it is changed like anything. Interconnected cars, self-driving vehicles, you know, whatever you have with you, which is connected to internet, is making you, you know, bring closer to the latest technologies because it is available in the industry. So the kind of vehicles or the kind of products that we use to produce, with the change and the impact in the industry, we may not survive or sustain for a longer duration if we also do not change ourselves. The fourth point is the globally interconnected industry. Now, there has been a lot of statements about that, you know, supply chain should be nearer to the place of production. gone are those days. You know, you can get anything that you want, you know, available on the internet with the time agreement that you need across the globe. And so when the globalization happened, everybody wants the best thing to be, you know, getting them, getting reached to their customers with a competitive edge price. So today, while sitting in Faridabad, in a Delhi NCR region, we are selling tractors across the globe. We are selling cranes across the globe. And similarly, the supply chain, our dealers, our suppliers, our channel partners, especially our vendors who are actually giving us the raw material for assembling and producing a tractor, they are available across globally. So there is a huge, advancements in the latest technologies with the quality and the price that has happened with connecting with the across the world industries and companies. The last part is the changing face of mobility infrastructure. So there has been a huge question when people are talking about that, do we really need to buy a house or a car? Do we really need to invest in a vehicle that is, you know, is a fixed asset to you? There have been a lot of advertisements coming in the TV today that saying that, you know, do you really need a car to buy? Why do you need a car to buy? So, or even now post COVID, I think a lot of organizations are really thinking about, do we really need to have an office? A company like us, which is almost a 70-year-old organization into a manufacturing setup, we may not need, you know, a place for people who can work from home, or they can work from anywhere. Or do we really need to have a factory setup which is at one place and a lot of investments? Can we have an infrastructure that can be built in, pick it up and put it over there nearby, which can, you know, which can reduce a lot of cost of traveling, of arranging things at one location? So there has been a huge change which is there in the Indian automotive sector. Now, now these are few which I have taken up from the PwC report. There could be a number of things that can be added to it. I'll go forward and I'll look at the challenges in the Indian automotive industry, because we talked about what has happened here, latest trends, which are the positive trends. But as an industry today, what are the bigger challenges that as an organization, as an industry, we feel today? So what certain things are a positive part to it, there are also negative part to it, or rather than say negative, there are challenges to it. So one of the biggest challenge that we see is excess production. Today, when COVID happened, the entire value chain got disrupted. Whatever was available, everything was produced and stored, but even the storage is a cost. So today, even the biggest players in the industry like Maruti in the automotive sector, they're also facing a similar kind of challenge in terms of how to keep the cost at a minimal without a price increase, with the meeting the actual demand. The inventories, I remember in 2010-11, the inventories that we used to keep, you know, more about 15 days of inventory, 20 days of inventory, has come down to 2 to 3 days of inventory. That is the organizations are trying to be more leaner so that the cash flow availability is there with the organizations. So there is a huge challenge in keeping up with the products that we produce and the investment we put in into our manufacturing setup and the price at which we sell the product. The second thing is connected technologies. So today, everybody is talking about Industry 4.0. I have put in a slide also on that, how it has evolved over a period of time. But nobody looks at the biggest concern today is also about privacy, about data leakage. Today, we do not know what we are connecting to our technologies and who is accessing what data, where it can be used, how it can be used. So everybody is moving towards, and this is a bigger challenge across the globe. It is not only in India, it is also across the globe that they are all facing a similar kind of challenge. They all understand that it is very important to save the user data, the consumer data, the employee data. But everything today, everybody wants to have the expectation. Again, the customer expectation is really going up. Everybody's running towards it, but there are also when it backfires, it really backfires very badly. And there have been a lot of cases in the recent past of data theft, because data is the key today. It is available in abundance. How it needs to be used, that is a bigger question to be asked. The third challenge is the self-driving evolution. Now everybody across the globe is running towards creating a self-driving vehicle, especially like an industry like us. When we talk about manufacturing, like a manufacturing product, like a tractor also. So we launched a autonomous tractor, electric tractor in last 3 years. Now it's more of a concept that is there available, but when it comes to actually driving it within the farm fields, now looking at the Indian setup, it becomes really difficult, because the farmland size is very, very small, and the kind of investment that you put in today's technology is very, very high. Similarly, the testing time, the testing data analysis, and the structure where it is built around, the entire ecosystem it is built around, it is taking a huge lot of time, wherein the infrastructure on the road sector, on the villages sector, they're not been completely developed. But this is a bigger challenge, because that is the need of the hour coming out in the future. Companies like Tesla, who have already been testing self-driven vehicles, it's been put it on the Lord alpha beta modes, and they have been using these vehicles. There is a huge demand that is going to come in the next couple of years. The fourth part is sustainability. Now, we all understand that the kind of fuel, the kind of energy that we use today is not going to last forever. That is why there is a huge focus, and government is also trying to put in a lot of focus on sustainability. Now, what does sustainability stands for? It stands for primarily utilizing and creating sources of sources for renewable or energy that can be given back to the society. So whatever we consume today, it should not deplete. It should be replenished in a similar fashion back to the environment, back to the industry. Now, there could be n number of factors. For example, sustainability today, how much of waste that we produce in an industry? It has been measured today. What are we doing to reduce our water wastage? What are we doing to look at the Paris Act, which we recently talked about reducing the emission norms, is coming from sustainability. And a lot of organizations are like, we recently saw Apple introduced a new iPhone and say that we are going to be zero carbon footprint in next 10 years and 15 years. The reason being that is that everybody wants to contribute to the society back. And if we are depleting the environment, the natural resources, it's going to cost us much more that we currently that we are harming. The fifth point is the shift of ownership to access. Now, in this area, what I earlier also talked about is today, you have everything on subscription model available. Starting from, to Amazon Prime account, to using annual insurance renewal, to buying a car on car lease, taking a car on lease, on rental agreement. There has been a huge focus where we're talking about, rather than buying a vehicle, using it to access it. Now, everybody in the industry knows this is going to happen today or tomorrow. The Olas of the world are going to, take it. The Ubers of the world are going to take that lead. Recently, Maruti also introduced a similar kind of model where you don't need to buy a car, but you can still access it on the rental model. That is, in the past, various surveys have been, put in together, wherein which shows that people do not want to, own an asset if they can access it. So that's a bigger challenge for a industry today for us. The sixth point is the millennial woes. Now, due to huge change in the generation gap, there is I think a huge complexity that has come in the kind of vehicle that we produce earlier and now, the kind of work that the new generation wants to work in, the involvement they want to get into, but nobody wants to get into those complexities. Everybody wants to open their own business, want to run their own business, but when it comes to dealing with such situations on the ground, similar like a big manufacturing setup, it is a huge area that still the industry needs to find a way out. There has been a huge demand and major challenges how today millennials look at problems, they look at solutions. And it is not the way that, tell them that to work hard for 14 hours and you'll be able to succeed. No, they say, can I work for 4 hours and give you the solution? Why should I need to work for 4 hours? Now, that's a challenge for a traditional kind of a setup wherein they're still in that industrial, the transition of the industrial 4.0. So there has been a huge change in the complexities, what we talked about also on the production line, on the ground, on the assembly lines. And, getting a new talent from campus, especially with the millennial generation, it's very difficult to get them involved and retain for a longer duration. They ask, what do you have to store for me for next 2 years? What do you have to store for me for 3 years? And the industry is not moving that fast. There has been, huge technological advancements on the ground, which they are more, aware, but don't want to get into doing things on the ground. The last and one of the most important factors is the retention of talented workforce. So this is one of the most significant challenges across the globe. For you have good people, but good people also aspire to have good career, good future aspiration. And similarly, in a similar kind of environment wherein there is a huge consumer interest changing, digitization happening, connected cars, connected products, there has been a huge demand also in people who can actually give you the right solutions on the ground. Because at the end of the day, the gap between what the customer needs and what we are producing or is going to produce needs to be lesser and lesser. And that can only happen with the various data inputs that we can get from the latest technologies, latest surveys, and create a workforce which can manage that. Now, in the various surveys, I remember one of the survey recently, which happened by NASSCOM, which is on the future of jobs in India, but it's like a 2022 perspective. It says that automotive sector and its employee, will continue. They will continue to hire at the rate of about 2 to 3% on an annual basis. And this data has come at lesser. The historical data is about 3 to 4%. So that means, if I look at the 24-25 data, it says there's about 60 to 65 new skill sets are required in the future. Now, what are those new skill sets? How can those skill sets be, acquired or attained over a period of time? I'll get into more into the next slide. So just a small glimpse of how the industrial revolution has taken place over a period of last 4 years. And in the last four phases. Starting from 18th century to 21st century today, how intelligence and AI is taking place of the entire change in the industrial revolution. I'll not spend much time here. I'll talk more about what we need today. These are the latest future skills that are required in industry. Again, I've put in the source of data information here. So these are about eight skills that we need to develop. Now, I'll talk more about it, how this can be integrated with the current requirements at the academy, because we need to understand that all of this or some of it is already happening some way or the other. But these are skills that even the current industries would also need. So starting from AI-based autonomous vehicles to big data and data analytics. Now, the kind of internet services available today and the kind of data that is available today, it's humongous. we need to really understand what is the correct data needs to be taken out from that data. Similarly, my current workforce today, you know, with an average age of an employee with us as an organization is about 38. We look at how we can create all those vehicles, you know, within the industry setup today, because it's going to change the entire face of the Indian industry next couple of years. Similarly, electrification today, if I look at 5 years ago, the infrastructure which was available and the mindset which was available for getting electric vehicles versus today, wherein all the bigger automotive organizations today are looking at creating completely going electric by 2030, creating electric vehicles by 2025. And we need to understand this, that the infrastructure plays a very vital role here. Very vital role. Because you create a vehicle, but if you don't know how to charge, you don't know how much battery will be consumed. And the bigger, I think the bigger challenge is also the usage part. So, you know, there is a term called battery management system for lithium-ion or lithium batteries. How do we store those batteries? Today, your cell phone, it becomes too hot if it blasts because it has a 4,000, 5,000 mAh battery. What happens to a 50,000 mAh battery if it blasts? It becomes really hot. If it's transferred from one place to another, where will you dispose it? How will you store it? What temperature? You know, those things, those questions are still a big challenge to a lot of Indian manufacturers. Then augmented reality. Now, this is one of the latest trends in last 4 to 5 years that people are getting into. You know, that it's the reality is not there, but it's closer to reality. It's very closer to, and you augment that it's there. Person is there, the location is there, the things are there. Now, this is where we need to start training people, because very handful of people really understand that the difference also between augmented reality or virtual reality or AI. Some of the most skills talk about share mobility. So everything is connected today, from your handset to your cell phone, to your car, to your machine or to your data. You know, it needs to have the, this is another skill that, you know, as an organization, as an industry today, we would need that in the future. Because of internet connectivity and data connectivity, everything we're talking today will be interconnected. The next one is additive manufacturing, which is more towards 3D printing. The technology is there. It is there in part of education. It's there in part of industry. Very few industries are looking towards it because there is a huge investment which is there at the start of the at the start of adopting this technology. The number of parts are really, really high. If you look at the number of parts, you know, 5,000 parts, 6,000 parts. That is needed on a daily basis. A build model versus a buy model, which is more cheaper in the long run. You know, all those things are still to be, you know, a lot of industries are still exploring. And again, I'll not get into more into blockchain and Internet of Things. These are all the skills that are there already, which is available on the internet. You can check more about it. But these are technologies which are there, and it's coming at a very fast pace. I remember about 3 years ago, we were doing a conversation with a few of the employees, and one of the guys asked, "Sir, what is the future of, you know, IC engine? What is the future of engine in the industry?" So one of very senior leaders in the organization said, "Engine is going to die in the next 10 to 15 years. There will be no engine. So if there will be no engine, what is going to happen?" If it's a battery operated vehicle, that means there's lesser interconnected parts that would be there. So, you know, you may not have a transmission. You may have a motor attached to it. You may have only, you know, today about, if you have about 5,000 parts, there could be about only 2,000 parts or even lesser parts. That means the actual vehicle shelf life or running life becomes much longer. Today, if a vehicle, we say in India, a vehicle is about 5 years old and it people start, you know, thinking of buying another vehicle, another car, then it's going to take up from 5 years to about 8 years, 9 years, because the usage of the actual product is going to deplete and is going to reduce the depletion. And that is why we need to really understand that it's going to change very, very fast. Okay. Similarly, these are more towards how the entire, if these skills come in, how the entire value chain also gets changed. So moving from a supplier network, from autonomous emergency braking system, we call it, you know, from and these are all we're talking about within the ecosystem, you know, supplier network to automotive manufacturers to marketing scale to end market to after sales, you know, these are all the things that is already happening within the industry. These are all the skills that is going to happen and going to go within our ecosystem with the suppliers, with dealers, with customers, and this is where we need to really start looking at how do we build you know, a gap, bridge that gap between academia and the industry. What is the future there? So if we talk about present skills today and knowledge, we are, you know, we are focusing on skill and knowledge, addressing current challenges, industry dependency, looking at employee benefits, technology and comfort. These are all the things that we're currently looking at for a period of time. And what is the future there? Future is more about, you know, skill and technology, AI, VI, AR, electrification. You know, there is a terminology moving from health and wellness to health and well-being. Complete end-to-end, you know, solution approach towards looking at for the entire employee workforce. Then, you know, employee satisfaction starts becoming, you know, employee nurturing. So there is a huge change that we need to bring in, and the bridge can be picked up. I'll just put in three areas. You know, the academia and the industry needs to have more interaction and more live projects. You know, there should be a continuous. I don't know how, you know, if you look at outside India, this is very, very high. If within India, I think it has not really fly. You know, it has not really taken that flight, because industries more feel that the academy is more of theoretical practice, and you know, a lot of research is required on the ground with the current technology advancements that manufacturing needs. So one, there should be a lot of live projects that needs to be there within the organization, outside the organization. Similarly, I think there's a continuous effort that needs to go through creating a collaboration. When I say collaboration, it means that a lot of future research and development needs to happen with the academia. And again, it is not about only doing a research, it is about sustainable future models that can be created both for the consumer industry. Today, we see India becoming one of the biggest hubs for, you know, startups. We have the highest number of unicorns coming across the globe. And the reason being that the startup, because, you know, getting the idea is one part, but getting the infrastructure and ecosystem to take that idea to the actual execution on the ground, you know, still there's a huge opportunity there. The third part I put in is industry incubation. They all are interconnected, you know. So a lot of organizations today, like I'll give you our example. In last couple of years, we have been primarily focusing on, you know, creating those opportunities with various colleges across India, including IITs, to have incubation. Understand, you know, come in there, you know, faculties would come in, students would come in and do some projects with us, which can, you know, change the entire model of the industry. So I'll give you certain examples. We evolved one of the ideas called Traxi. Now, what is a Traxi model? It's like a tractor taxi model. This is like we did a lot of, you know, research in the various tractor owners on the ground, where we create a small app where they can actually go and book a tractor on rent, book an equipment on rent on the app. Now, how is going to help? If you look at agriculture data, about 80%, 81% of the farmers today do not have more than 2 hectares of land. The industry of tractor today, being in the mechanical industry, is about 8 lakh tractors a year. That means 8 lakh new tractors are being bought every year. And the actual buyer is not the 81% of farmers. It is the 19% of farmers who actually have more than 2 hectares of land. Now, how do we bring in more than those 81% of people within the industry so that they can also become efficient to purchase a product? So this is one of the areas that there are a lot of other areas. For example, there are crop solutions. Now, moving from a traditional product selling company to an end-to-end solution-based company, that is the future that we're talking about. Starting in from identification of soil, what kind of soil it is, what kind of nutrient it has, to sowing, to preparing land, to actually, you know, giving that all that skill and need which is required for to the actual product that will produce, then harvesting, then from harvesting, collection to distribution to making meet the end customer. That's the entire value chain. Now, today, if you look at India, there is a huge challenge in the distribution and the storage, the dry storage and the cold storage. That is again a problem area that a lot of, you know, companies are looking at how we can create a better infrastructure around you know, creating a food grain. Now this is again coming in from the actual experience that we recently, there was a report published by WHO which said that more than 43% of the products of the produce that we produce in India is wasted. That's a big number. So that means there is a huge opportunity for today for academia to look at solutions which can build in and reduce the gap from the actual production to the actual consumer. And that is where all of your recent startups from growers to, you know, small startups coming in the environment that they can go to a direct producer and making them meet the end customer. But again, it's all related to your future skills. So we need to integrate those future skills with the current academic structure. So I think I'm done with the slides here. I'll now ask, I'll ask.